Wooldridge.
Hello, everybody. Boy, walking in tall cotton tonight. Whew, this is great. What an honor to be with you. This is terrific. I'm going to change things up a little bit. I'm going to take you into the world of the Blue Angels for a little while, and then I'm going to circle back to someone who is very, very special to our teams and the history of the Blue Angels, and right back into Vietnam. In the meantime, let's get fired up. Let's soar, Oregon. Here we go.
I think every naval aviator aspires to achieve all those tenets that you need to have to become a Blue Angel. And I think those of us that were lucky enough to fly jets early in our careers probably always thought about the Blue Angels as being something very spectacular, with the flying being very challenging and being a privilege to be able to do that.
We got the same recruiters that are standing outside of Top Gun Maverick to come here tonight, so they're right outside the door if anybody's fired up. I think some of us need a little gray hair waiver or something, but I am so glad to be here. Glad to be here. I wouldn't want to be any place else in the world. Glad to be here. It's something that Blue Angels said all the time. It was reflective of the culture of excellence that surrounded us when we were there. We said it. We meant it. That appreciation for flying those jets, going out and being with the American public, and more importantly, linking up with that team that we had that was so precious, so incredible, built on gratitude, the glad to be here gratitude. The foundation was concrete, right there firm. But let me tell you something else that went with that concrete. What goes with concrete to keep it solid from cracking? Rebar, right? Trust. Trust was the rebar of that foundation of excellence, that culture. I'll talk about that a little bit later, but glad to be here. You'll hear that in my lexicon all the time. It was really special. How did the Blue Angels get started? Why? Admiral Nimitz said, coming back from the South Pacific, he said, you know what, the people in the heartland of America are going to forget about naval aviation, about the impact that those Navy and Marine Corps pilots had on winning that war in the South Pacific. So he said, I want you, Butch Voris, 26-year-old fighter ace, to form a team, and I want you to go across America. And he did, and it was extremely popular and successful. He created an iconic American event and team. It was terrific. Round the country he went without anybody ever saying a word negative. It was the greatest thing for naval aviation. And it's lasted 76 years. So we're still going strong today. I'm often asked, what do you remember most about being a Blue Angel? Well, Did we get to fly some cool places? Yeah. Sea Fair, Seattle every year. That was terrific. Sailboat top level. San Francisco, through between the Coit Tower and the Transamerica building for Fleet Week. Can't get away with that. That was terrific. What I enjoyed most was the kids. The kids were our target audience. We wanted to influence young people into doing what we were doing, but in a much broader sense. We wanted to help them realize those hopes and dreams that were going through their minds when they saw something like this. American exceptionalism. We wanted to strike that spark. First time I signed an autograph, a little girl came up to me and she looked at me and I looked in her eyes and I said, oh, those are cool sneakers, you know, you got to make that heart-to-heart thing. And so I'm signing, I barely get to the end of the autograph and she's off. I go, wait, I'm the boss here, come on. I realized right then, it's not about you, Wooldridge. It's about a purpose larger than self. And that's what I found through all my military career. You can do your best, you're expected to do your best, but it's not about you, it's about the mission, the purpose. That purpose larger than any of us. And that's what it was all about with the Blue Angels. And it was so relieving, you know. You did your best. Everybody did their best. But that's what the military was all about. It was just fabulous. We had a real leveling experience every week when we fly to cities. And that was when we would have the challenge kids come out. Make-A-Wish would bring all their kids out. And it was, you know, some people would say to you, well, you must feel like rock stars flying those airplanes, traveling all over the world, all over the country. Well, no, because we got to interact with these kids that woke up every morning not knowing what that day was going to bring. And I'll tell you what, they were our heroes. They were something else. Kids, they were fantastic. The team, the Blue Angel team, can't say enough about them. They would work 24 hours a day, if need be, to have those planes ready to go. And then we'd get to borrow them for an hour. It was great. Thank you very much. You folks did all the work. We'll go up and flash around, get all the attention. They're the ones that deserve the attention. They were the thunder of the lightning, as George Will used to say. They were the foundation. Working all the time. Whatever it took, fantastic. And that trust continued to run through the way we did things. But there was a word that came in there that helped describe why it was so important to know each other, and that was respect. That was the secret sauce to making this team, these teams that I was on, the best they could possibly be. And it was because you recognized people and you said, I don't, you know, you, in the back of your mind, you're going, it doesn't matter what you do. If you're on this team, you're doing something really important. And I respect you for that. I respect you for the fact that you're doing it to your utmost. And that was so invigorating. It really was. We respected each other, no matter what. And it really showed through. All right. In addition to respect, and I know I've just got little bit of time. I'll stay in there. Don't worry. I want to hear the general's remarks and Steve's, so I'm not going to snag too much more time. So the trust thing was huge. And I want to show you a clip here about why trust was so important, and not just between the folks working on the airplanes, but also between us pilots. I want you to, in this clip, tell me how many airplanes are in the clip. Here we go. How many airplanes?
Four.
Yeah, hard to believe, isn't it? Holy moly, that's great stuff. If you put your hand up over your head, between the top of your head and your fingertips, that's how close they are, going almost 400 miles an hour, 22-ton jets, The trust was fabulous. All right, let's swing back to why we're here tonight. An example of the trust and the love between us. You know, you don't often say in a military organization, well, I love you, man. Well, we loved each other. We didn't put it necessarily in those open words, but we did. We had a great, great time. All right, here's where I want to bring you back to. Who's this guy? Went to Evergreen High School, Clark College, Vancouver, right across the river from us here. He was the commanding officer, flight leader of the Blue Angels from 1970 to 1971. Flying Phantoms, F-4s. Couldn't wait to finish his tour with the Blues to get back to the fleet and fly Phantoms again. The name of his squadron was the Something Dogs, and I won't say it because it's dinner time, but it was a great outfit. He couldn't wait to get back. That's what he wanted to do. This guy was so revered that as a junior commander, he was being talked about for in his later years being the Chief of Naval Operations. He was the real deal. January 1973, he's in doing close air support. They take a hit, he and his backseater. They had the feet wet, trying to get out where the helos could get them. Didn't make it. Both had to eject. They're coming down. The guy in the backseat reports later all the gunfire they were being shot at as they came down in the parachutes. Not the way we would do business in our world. Harley didn't make it. Talks that he was shot in the parachute, talks that he was shot on the ground. And there are a lot of clouds around what happened to Harley Hall. He was the last American, did I say this already, the last American shot down in Vietnam, January of 73. So as you go through this evening, think about these American heroes and what we can do to continue to light a light, put a candle in front of what our heroes have done, so we can all see it, we can all feel it, we can all experience it, and never forget it. So with that, thank you for letting me be up here. I had a great time. Glad to be here.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a brief 10-minute break for you all to enjoy your...